everyone. Today we're going to look at three different ideas: taxonomy, systematics, and phylogeny. Now, there's a good chance in high school you probably studied taxonomy, but you might not have got to systematics or phylogeny. Those second two words are going to aid us as we try to look at how classifying organisms will give us more detail into their evolutionary history. So let's go ahead and get started. Let's imagine you're walking through the forest and you happen to spot this little critter on the forest floor. Upon first glance, you may possibly classify this as a... And I'm guessing in your mind you're coming up with a word, it's popping right into your head, but the problem is it isn't that thing. How do we know that? Well, we know that by looking at its characteristics. For example, it has characteristics like these. It does not have a fused eyelid. I believe the animal you're thinking of does, but instead this animal can close its eyes. It does not have a short tail posterior to its anus. It happens to have a very long tail with an anus just before that long tail. And that's due to its ability to what's called tail drop in order for this animal to survive. And lastly, this animal does not have a highly mobile jaw like the animal you're thinking of. Instead, this animal must obtain prey that's smaller than its own head because it's not able to unhinge its jaw to enable to eat large prey. So there's no doubt that you're probably thinking snake upon first looking at it, but once we get into the characteristics of this animal, the same characteristics that are going to help us classify it using a branch of science called taxonomy, we see that it's not a snake at all. Instead, this is a legless lizard. So our species is into organizing life, and we do so through a branch of biology called taxonomy. Its concerns are identifying, naming, and classifying organisms. In an earlier lecture, we talked about a taxonomic hierarchy, and we did so for the gray wolf. And what this was a list of terms that we use as we classify our organism, trying to put them in particular categories based on their characteristics, which can be quite extensive. So we have very general terms that tend to be on the top of this hierarchy, and then we have very detailed terms that represent the bottom levels of this hierarchy. So let's go ahead and review that just for a second. At the top, we had the category domain, which was the largest all-inclusive category of this list here. Next one down, we had kingdom. Third, we had phylum. Class, order, family, genus, and species. So again, this list goes from very detailed very general characteristics down all the way to very detailed characteristics. So the time we get down to these two levels right here, we've basically keyed out our organism. And this one's particular name, the gray wolf, would be called Canis lupus for short. But all of these other ones here are part of its name as well as we get scientific with this taxonomy. Now, all of those levels are collectively known as taxa, a group of organisms that exhibit a set of shared traits. Now, if we look at those particular words, some will describe these groups under the word domain as being nested, because one group exists within another group. So, for example, species of lupus down here, what we're going to have is it's going to sit within the genus Canis, which has more than just the species lupus. Just like the genus Canis is going to fall into the bigger grouping of family Canidae. Canidae represents dog-like animals, and we're going to have a number of genera, which is plural for genus, that's going to fit in Canidae. And we're also going to have a lot of families that exist in orders, and we can keep moving up this scale here vertically to then eventually reach the top of domain Eukarya. To understand the idea of nested levels, let's take a look at the species Panthera pardus, but we'll do so from the bottom and we'll work our way up. Now, while we do this, I also want you to think of another thing. I want you to think of your global address. Think of where you live. And what we'll do is we'll go from the very general, since we all live on planet Earth together, to the very specific. For example, down at the bottom here, you see our three domains. We have domain bacteria, we have domain eukarya, and we have domain archaea. However, because we all live on planet Earth, just like all these animals, we could go ahead and think of our global address as, what hemisphere do I live in? I personally live in the Western Hemisphere, so I've kind of knocked out that level of classification. Now, I can keep moving up. For example, the next level is kingdom. And what I can do then is say, okay, what continent do I live in? Because I know there's a lot of continents on the planet, and each one falls into a particular hemisphere. So the continent I live on is North America. And I can keep moving up this set of levels until I reach my global address. Phylum, chordata. Next step for us would be moving up from the continent to zero in on the country we live in. Well, I live in the United States of America, and we'll keep moving upward. Class Mammalia. What state do you live in? Orders, Carnivora. What county do you live in? Family, Felidae, your city. And genus, Panthera, what street do you live on? And last but not least, as we're zeroing in through the traits at Panthera pardus, if we were zeroing in on where you live, what is your street address? It's that simple. So as you know, we have a lot of street addresses. They're going to make it onto your street, but you have that one particular number. You have a lot of streets in your city. You have a lot of cities in your county, possibly. A lot of counties in your state, if you're from the United States of America. A lot of states in your country, and you can keep thinking of each one of these higher ones here as nested in the one below it. So we kind of took the last slide, we flipped it upside down, and we're looking at the nested aspect from the top down. Similarly, we can look at the species Panthera pardus and see that there's a number of species that fall into the genre Panthera. In fact, there's four that we can see here. There's a number of genera that fall into the family Felidae, which are most of the cats on our planet. There is a lot of families in the order Carnivora, where Felidae just makes up one. So you can see how, on a species level, we can go through the same nesting pattern as we saw with our addresses. The attempts to classify things around us could date all the way back to the Greek philosophers, but in the mid-18th century, Carolus Linnaeus developed the binomial system of nomenclature to classify organisms. So he was looking at living things. And the two most detailed taxa that we look at for that are the genus and the species, where first word being genus, the second word being referred to as the specific epithet. This refers to one species of potentially many within that genus. So when we're referring to a particular species, we refer to it by its full binomial name, the genus and the species. If we just are talking using the genus term for that particular animal, there's going to be other animals or plants within that particular genus as well. So they're all going to be very closely related in some way, or at least should be. So what do genus and species actually specify? Well, if we want to get more detailed about it, we could say that the genus represents a group of organisms that share many common characteristics. A species is a group of organisms with the highest level of shared characteristics, and most importantly, can successfully interbreed with each other. That is the number one key for being classified into a particular species. So what's important for the biology student to remember? Well, there's a few things. So as we look to write taxonomic information, we got to do a few things. Make sure a few things are there. For example, we must italicize both genus and the species, and we must capitalize the genus. So if I was doing a report on the gray wolf or Canis lupus, I'm going to start off with a capital letter C. I'm going to go ahead and italicize the best I can. I'll probably be using a computer, but I'll do my best by hand. And I'm going to leave the species first letter in a lowercase. So that's my cursive L right there. You may use, you can use a single capital letter for the genus with the species if mentioned previously. So if I'm talking about the gray wolf and I refer to Canis lupus a number of times, I only need to refer to it one time in the beginning of the report as Canis lupus, and then for the rest of the report, I'm going to still italicize, I'm going to still capitalize my C, and then I'm going to put a period after it, and I'm going to just use the species name. So C. lupus italicized will do the job. Whatever the organism is named, it must have a Latin ending. Now, the chances are you're not going to probably be naming an organism yourself, but if you go into the world of biology, that just may happen. So we'll take a look at some of the other things that go into naming in the next few slides. Now, just because there's a lot of rules of taxonomy doesn't mean we can't have a little bit of fun with it as well. So, for example, take a look at some of the names of these organisms that biologists have come up with. So I gotta say, the biologists who discovered these guys probably had a little bit of fun in naming it. Now, you can't have too much fun, however, because you might be able to, if you're having too much fun, violate some of the standards. So what allows a scientist to call a certain organism a certain name? Well, there's two basic overseeing codes that do that. One is the International Code of Zoological Nomenclature, or ICZN, and the International Code of Botanical Nomenclature, or ICBN. And what these do, they're kind of governing bodies that look at the names that you're calling these organisms, and they have a few rules that they've come up with. The zoological nomenclature is going to be your animals, the botanical nomenclature is going to be your plants, and here are those rules. Authors should exercise reasonable care and consideration in forming new names to ensure that they are chosen with subsequent users in mind, and that, as far as possible, they're appropriate, compact, euphonious, memorable, and do not cause offense. So I would say none of these are truly offensive. Maybe the Villa Manila, which kind of reminds me of Milli Vanilli, whose music was truly offensive. But anyways, organisms are very diverse. They have a lot of characteristics that go with them. And some of them just present themselves, and to our human minds, we tend to smile when we see certain animals. And that may lead us to a fun-sounding name. For example, some of those animals that could do so are ones like these. This is called the pink fairy armadillo, or Clymphoris truncatus. This thing exists. It's actually around us in this world. Another one, this guy. That's called an eye. I'm not even going to try to say its scientific name, but yeah, that's interesting. Next, we have what's called a maned wolf. And even though these characteristics are quite extreme, it has survived and is around us today. This guy right here is called the Dumbo octopus. And if you go ahead and you were to translate its name from Latin, it means small jellyhead butt. And lastly, one of the most amazing things that we'll see in this world around us is what we call the bird of paradise, or the Parotia cephalata. So you can see this dance that it's doing right now to woo this female is quite extreme. And this gives us the ability to look with a little bit of a light heart at nature around us and have a little bit of fun too. So why are scientific names needed at all? Well, look no further than these two flowers. These are both types of lilies. Well, the one on the left is yellow, has spots all around on its petals. The one on the right is red, and it looks very different from the one on the left. Well, that also means that the chemicals inside of them are going to be different as well. The one on the left happens to be named Lilium canadense. The one on the right is Lilium bulbiferum, two different species of lilies. Let's go to another example. What is the difference in the fish that you see here? We have jellyfish, crawfish, and silverfish. Can't come up with it? Well, let's take a look at some pictures that go with each one. There's a jellyfish, there's a crawfish, and there's a silverfish. None of them are actually fish as we know it. The jellyfish is what we call a cnidarian. The crawfish and silverfish are what we call arthropods, where the crawfish is a crustacean and the silverfish is an insect that we don't like very much when it shows up in our house. But if we zero in on just one of these, for example, the crawfish, even the crawfish has multiple names associated with it, such as crayfish, crawdad, freshwater lobster, or mudbug. All of these are additional names that the same general animal is called. So what scientific names are going to do are they're going to help us with figuring out which one is which. Common names vary both locally and globally. Languages vary. And if you think about it, it's similar to the need for the metric system of measurements. If people have their own words to describe certain quantities, it's going to make trade very difficult. But if everybody is using the same system, such as binomial nomenclature, it makes it much, much easier to key out organisms and get a very particular decision on a species showing certain characteristics. So classification lists the unique characters of each taxon and is intended to reflect what we call phylogeny. So there's that word that we saw on that first slide. Phylogeny is referring to the evolutionary history of a particular organism. But the problem is it doesn't always do so. You may look at traits of an organism and expect them to be very similar to another one, but in terms of evolution, they have very little connection to each other. So that calls for a need of something called systematics, an analytical branch of biology that's going to rely on fossil record data, comparative anatomy, embryonic development, and molecular data to determine those evolutionary history and relationships, which we call phylogenies. So if we look at these pictures here, we can see fossil record data is definitely going to help us connect one type of animal to another, or a type of plant with another. We have comparative anatomy and development. So as we look at different body parts, we tend to look for the same type of structures reappearing and how they develop through embryology. And lastly, and one of the most important today, is the use of molecular data. Taking a look at all the A's, T's, C's, and G's in the genome of various species and see, are there connections in the DNA and RNA of organisms that allow us to build the phylogeny, to build a picture of the evolutionary history of this organism or set of organisms? As we try to decipher evolutionary history, one way that we do it is by way of what's called a phylogenetic tree. It's going to be a visual layout of all of the organisms under study to understand their connectedness over time. So a diagram like this that indicates lines of descent is going to give us information about all of the animals that you see here. Now, as we look at the actual picture here, you notice that we have a number of branching points. And these branching points are points of divergence, where one goes one pathway, another one goes a different pathway. But the important thing is they represent what's called a common ancestor. So at one time, there was a four-legged creature that a bear and a chimpanzee once had a long time ago, which each went their own directions in terms of their own evolution, which gives us the animals that are here today. And we call these points of divergence, these places where a common ancestor exists, as nodes. So in this particular picture here, where we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 animals, we can note that we have 5 nodes. We have 5 common ancestors that occurred along the way. Now, of course, there's a lot more animals present today than these 6, but however, they did have common ancestors that all met at a certain point a long time ago. We're going to be focusing in on 2 types of characters when we construct one of these phylogenetic trees. The first type of characters are called common characters. And what that means is that it's present in all members of a group and present in the common ancestor, which is what we call ancestral traits. That in combination with what we call derived characters. Derived characters are present in some members of a group, but absent in the common ancestor. In other words, those traits were not seen previously. So if we take a look at our picture down here, again, we have 6 animals, a little bit different from the last slide, but that's okay. Note that we have what's called the common character or shared ancestral trait, which is down here at the bottom. Now, derived characters are going to occur on the way of evolution as these other animals develop over time. So, what is the common character that we see here? Well, what we're going to see is the presence of a dorsal neural nerve cord in all of these animals, and that's what we find right here at this stem. However, in one of the animals that came from it, this lancelet, there this particular group of animals did not develop any bone to enclose that dorsal neural nerve tube. But all of these other animals, something that was derived, that came about over time, was they developed a bony structure that wrapped around that dorsal neural nerve cord. And everything that you see here, from the lamprey on down, all have the presence of a vertebral column. So that's derived. The common characteristic is that they have the nerve cord. Now, as we move further towards today, what we saw was the development of hinged jaws next. The lamprey did not develop it, but instead, all of these animals here, the tuna, salamander, turtle, and leopard, did. So those are derived amongst those species. And we can keep going from hinged jaws to four walking legs to the production of amniotic eggs all the way to hair. So we see more derived characters as we move forward on Earth's timeline. As we look at another phylogenetic tree, we can pull out different information that will be helpful in the long run as we try to understand them. For example, sister taxa. These two species are very closely related. We have Canis latrans and we have Canis lupus. So we have a gray wolf here, we have a red wolf here. They're sister taxa. Their common ancestor was the last known branching point that allowed latrans to differ from lupus in some way, where they no longer interbreed with each other. So they share an immediate common ancestor, in other words. All of the species that we see on this phylogenetic tree, however, are going to be rooted here at the base. The fact that they're all part of Carnivora, order Carnivora, which means that they all eat meat. And what we can say then is that the most recent of everything that you see here, all five of these, is going to be this point right here. Now, there's something that happened in terms of mutation, in terms of speciation, that allowed the cat family to go in this direction, and then the weasel and the dog families, or Canidae and Mustelidae, in this direction. Another thing that we can look at is the weaknesses of phylogenetic trees. Trees don't necessarily guarantee absolute ages of particular species. So, for example, if we try to focus in on the difference between these weasels, part of these weasel family here, and these dog families here, without fossil evidence, we can't be sure exactly which one of these branches, which one of these divergent points happened first. So absolute ages are not guaranteed, especially if you're going off of molecular data. We would need the fossil record in order to help us with that. But other than that, we can clearly see that there was branching points based on some kind of criteria of speciation that allowed one to go in one direction and another to go in another direction. How do we know that the construction of a phylogenetic tree is the best hypothesis of phylogeny? One way is through what's called cladistics, a method that uses shared and derived traits to hypothesize evolutionary history. This will usually consider the simplest solution, which we call parsimony, in the evolutionary history of your groups of organisms that are being studied. Your groups are going to be called a clade, and they represent a common ancestor in all of its descendant lineages. So what we have here is a clade consisting of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different types of animals. Biologists can construct what's called a cladogram, which is what you see here, to visually represent the derived characteristics of your trait, of your clade, which you can clearly see along this axis here. We can see mammary glands, hair, gizzard, epidermal scales, amniotic eggs, four limbs, vertebrae, notochord, and embryo. And simply, there is an X placed in every box where you see those traits. Now, importantly, we're always going to need to select what's called an outgroup, a species from an evolutionary heritage that diverged before the lineage that we're studying, also called the in-group. So in this case here, our lancelet is going to be called the outgroup because it has a notochord formed in its embryo. But that's it. All the rest of the traits that we're looking at, vertebrae, four limbs, eggs, scales, and so forth, you don't see that present. So we always kind of have almost like a control in each one of these cladograms, which is called the outgroup. The in-group is going to be the particular species that we're studying. And in this case here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 from tuna through the chimpanzees would be considered our in-groups. Notice that as we're trying to put together connectedness of these species, we're looking at the characteristics and placing those X's in the boxes where they seem to share those. For example, everything from tuna to the chimpanzee has vertebrae. However, tuna do not have four limbs, but the frogs through the chimpanzees do. We can then move up to amniotic eggs, which frogs do not have, but lizards through chimpanzees do. We can also look at the animals that have epidermal scales, and we find that only three of them out of those five have those scales. So we're beginning to allow for points of divergences among these animals under study within our in-group. Gizzards, a couple of the group have those, and hair, we have chimpanzees and dogs containing those characteristics, as well as mammary glands. So it's allowing us to basically come up with this picture, this hypothesis of how we believe that these organisms are related to each other in terms of evolutionary history. From that last cladogram, we're now able to go ahead and take a look at the finished product once that's changed into a phylogenetic tree. For example, our outgroup was down here. This was the lancelet. So this seems to have very little in common with everything else. Then the next thing we looked at was vertebrae, which allowed it to be different from the in-group. So the vertebrae being seen within the in-group made it different than the out-group, which allowed us to put all of them above in this area up here. We then saw the four limbs evolve over time, which allowed us to separate everything from the frog through the chimpanzee from the tuna. So the tuna went its own direction, and we're able to keep on making separations as we move up the phylogenetic tree. Amniotic eggs developed, evolved over time. However, the frog didn't take part in that, so that went its own direction. And as you can see, we can keep doing that, keep making distinctions from using that cladogram, which will translate into moves on our phylogenetic tree that isolates a given group from the rest, till eventually we can then have a nice picture of what we believe this evolutionary history to exist as. So two terms that we have to understand are clades and groups. So what's the difference of a clade versus a group? So a clade is what we refer to as a monophyletic group, and that means it consists of all ancestral species and all of its descendants. So in this case here, what we have is if we're studying animals A, B, and C, also known as group one, this is going to be a clade because all of the ancestral species and all of its descendants are listed here. Second, a paraphyletic group consists of an ancestral species and some, but not all, of its descendants. So as we look at animals D through G in group two, you'll notice that G has been left out of the picture. And what that means is that some, but not all, have made it into this. So this is not a clade. This is just what we call a paraphyletic group. Because a monophyletic group contains everyone, that's going to be referred to then as a clade. Okay? Thirdly, a polyphyletic group includes taxa with different ancestors. So if we're studying group animal C through animal G in group 3, notice that D through G came from the common ancestor that's found here. However, animal C did not. Instead, it had common ancestors here and here, which is unknown and unrelated from animals D through G. So that's considered a polyphyletic group. This is not a clade in here, and this is not a clade here. So let's go ahead and test ourselves and try to figure out if we are looking at a clade or not. So again, a clade must include all current species and all shared ancestors. Do we see it in animals D through F? Well, this is a monophyletic grouping, and it is a clade because it contains B, the closest common ancestor, and all of the descendants of B, which are D, E, and F. Let's look at picture two. This is what's called a paraphyletic grouping. It is not a clade because it lacks F. F did not make it into the shaded box, as we can see, because it is a descendant of ancestor B. And lastly, is this one a clade? Answer, no. This is a polyphyletic group. It lacks A, which is the closest common ancestor to all of the descendants that you see here. Instead, E and F seem to come from B, which H and I only come from G, not B, and therefore this is polyphyletic and not a clade. Some terms we use in cladistics are found here. Get used to seeing these and be able to use these in your vocabulary as you talk about evolutionary history. What an outgroup versus an in-group is when we talk about cladograms. What is an ancestral trait? What is a clade? What are shared derived traits? What's a monophyletic grouping? And what is parsimony, which we're going to get to in a little bit. One thing that's noteworthy about phylogenetic trees is that the length of a branch can reflect the number of genetic changes that may have taken place in a particular DNA sequence in that lineage. So we may be able to answer the question, which species has gone through the most genetic change as we look at the phylogenetic tree? For example, if we look at the Drosophila animal over here, the Drosophila insect, which is nothing more than our common fruit fly, we can see that there's not a whole lot of change from 542 million years ago. It just seems to have one branching point where the rest of these species, from lancelet to mouse, went through a number of DNA changes. So we can see 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 by the time we get to human and mouse. Now, were there more genetic changes than just 5? Of course there was. So these are just reflecting the amount of change that we're seeing as we compare Drosophila as the outgroup with all of these other ones in the in-group. And we can imagine then that the most genetic change from the Drosophila branching point, the common ancestor point down here, that the human and the mouse have gone through the most genetic change since that time. Remember that a phylogenetic tree is a hypothesis. What we're trying to do is we're trying to build the evolutionary history of those organisms under study. The problem is when you have more than one possible tree that could evenly become your outcome. And as you can see here, we have two trees that represent two possible scenarios as to how mushrooms, humans, and flowers, in this case, may have come about. So systematists can never be sure of finding the best tree in a large data set. What they have to do is apply the principles of maximum parsimony and maximum likelihood to the scenario that they're trying to analyze. Maximum likelihood states that given certain rules about how DNA changes over time, a tree can be found that reflects the most likely sequence of evolutionary events. And maximum parsimony assumes that the tree that requires the fewest evolutionary events is the most likely. So if we take a look at tree number one, notice that there's just two big events that are pretty evenly distributed amongst the possible outcomes. For example, it kind of shows a relationship between humans and mushrooms here at 15% and 15%, and we can see the difference between the two is also going to be a total of 30%. We can also see the difference between a human and a tulip is 40%. So if we add up these three numbers here and this one here, what we find is we have 15 and 5, that's 20, and another 20, that's 40. And the same thing goes with the mushroom and the tulip. There's a 40% difference there in DNA sequence. So again, very simply and evenly, you have the same scenario playing out here. Tree 2 has a lot more possibilities. Now, these lines stopping short don't give us a lot of confidence if they're saying that mushrooms died out a long time ago, followed by humans, and only plants are here today. But you can also see that 5% of the common ancestral traits were all that was left over for the mushroom. 10% went the other direction, which led the way for a common ancestor between human and plants. So this has a lot more possible events that had to occur to make this particular tree happen. This one is evenly spaced. They're all still with us here today. So tree one is most likely going to be our reasonable outcome when we apply maximum parsimony and the maximum likelihood about how events unfolded. We have to remember that phylogenetic trees are hypotheses. As new information is found, these hypotheses can be supported or rejected. And the best hypotheses for phylogenetic trees fit the most data: morphological data, molecular data, and fossil data. And this is going to be applied to infer features of dinosaurs from birds like this owl. So we can take morphological data, and that happens to be connected with fossil data quite often. So we can see the leftover remains, fossilized leftover remains of animals that have lived in the past. We can look at tracks and evidence they have left behind. And we can even look at molecular data based on what we're able to find in the still soft tissue that we found preserved in some prehistoric remains. We can also look at insects that drew blood from these animals and hopefully get a good particular sample that allows us to sequence out the data from different species of prehistoric animals. And that's going to lead us to information like this, which is the current belief system, the current hypothesis, that we have what began as dinosaurs over time evolve into what has become today's living birds. What is some other information we can glean by studying phylogeny? Well, if a species is decimated and we need to bring a species back, knowing the closest relative of a species may provide a reservoir for genes found in your lost species. For example, most countries' agricultural systems consist of monocultures. That's when you have primarily one or two species dominating most of the crops that are grown. In doing so, however, you're also setting yourself up for potential disasters. Because what could happen is if you have a particular pathogen that unlocks the code for that particular plant, it could wipe them all out. So having a stockpile of the genetics and the morphology and the phylogenetics of species that are closely related could help you reconstitute either that plant or a close relative to that plant, so all is not lost and you can continue to produce food for the world's population. Another thing that we see more recently are threats of bioterrorism. For example, the anthrax scare post 9/11. Through phylogeny, through molecular data, they were able to trace where this particular species and type of anthrax had come from in order to determine its origin. What type of data allows us to infer phylogenetic information? Well, the two that we're going to look at most closely are morphological homologies and molecular homologies. So, with morphological homologies, we study homologous structures, which are structures that have a shared ancestry. If we take a look at the forelimbs of mammals, what we find are the same collection of bones in each one of those animals that's considered a mammal. For example, we have a scapula, a humerus, an ulna, and a radius, and a little bit distal from that, a carpal or carpus and metacarpals. If we look at the dog, we see the same type of bones. Pig, sheep, and horse, we all share the same types of bones because of our shared ancestry. And divergent evolution will eventually result in this, which are selective pressures of the environment. Means that these part of what makes a branching point on a phylogenetic tree are going to be the collective influences and pressures by that environment, which may allow one group to move in a different direction than another group. However, I will say this, beware of the analogous as well. Analogous structures are different than homologous structures. Analogous structures look the same, but they have completely different origins. For example, if I'm looking at these two animals down here, they look pretty similar. They have the same type of habitat, so I would assume that they came from a same line of descent, but I'd be wrong. One is considered a marsupial, the Australian mole, and the other one is considered the North American mole, which is a placental. So they have entirely different ways of reproducing and nursing their young from each other. And what's going to happen then is we have to be careful that they don't have a common ancestor and that they have come from two distinct lines of evolution. Now, molecular homologies, on the other hand, these are genes or other DNA sequences that are also homologous if they have descended from a common ancestor. And these are going to look quite a bit different than analyzing bones. Here, we're analyzing the A's, T's, C's, and G's of different species. And typically, what we find is the more sequence that is common between two, they tend to be more related. Let's look at a unique couple of examples of what we call homoplasies, which are essentially structures that perform the same function but have different lines of descent. For example, we may assume that bats and birds are very closely related to each other. But if we look at the phylogenetic tree, what we find is that there's actually quite a bit of difference between the two. For example, the ability of powered flight came about independently in bats from that of birds. So birds went their own way, but then in the other direction, we had some kind of animal that led to the two animals of mice and bats. And somewhere along the way, the bats took a turn for survival by developing the ability to fly themselves. But it was in no way connected to that of birds' ability to fly. So bats are actually more closely related to mice than they are to birds, even though they both fly. We could also say that about the insect. This honeybee, it has the ability to fly itself, but it's going to be nowhere near this structure on a phylogenetic tree. So why don't we just use fossils for everything? Well, the problem with the fossil record is it's good, but it's incomplete. It's often difficult to determine the phylogeny of a fossil. Now, typically hard parts are mineralized, but not all of them get mineralized. The problem is you must be buried very, very quickly and under the right conditions in order to actually become a fossil. And if you are a soft-tissued organism, you virtually have no chance of becoming a fossil because you'll decay before you're actually buried. So it's very difficult to find a complete fossil record just because of the geologic forces on the planet. Now, as you can see, we have a picture of a fossil here. These bones were likely created in these fossilized remains were likely created from bones that were buried, dissolved over time, filled up and mineralized with rock, and what we see today is the impression from the hollow chambers or the hollow compartments those bones created. We can also look at the continents and we can determine that there is a connectedness amongst fossils of the different continents, which adds to the idea and the set of ideas about Pangaea, that at one time all the continents were interconnected and over time they drifted apart. But we still have a lot of evidence showing that the same animals were found in the same bands, so migration patterns can then be looked at and studied. We can also use the fossil record in terms of dating animals that we find. And although not perfect, we can determine just by the rules of geology that as we go deeper, we tend to find older fossils. But with certain types of geologic behavior of rocks and upheaval, sometimes that will change. If you get a chance and you want to see how fossils are made, watch TED Ed, How to Fossilize Yourself. We also mentioned molecular homology, where we take the A's, T's, C's, and G's of DNA, compare them against each other, and try to determine the relationship of one species versus another. So here we have species A through H, and what we can do is we can take a look at the similarity, or how dissimilar they are, based on the letter code. So if we take a look at some of the relationships, we see some sister taxa that are out here. We see A and B. We see G and H being close together, E and F similar to G and H. And then we see C and D as well. Now, the one that seems to be the least related to the others are species A and B. So I should say the two species that seem to be the least related. Now, what you'll find is that at positions 2, 4, and 7, here, here, and here, there's some definite similarities between species A and B. But if we go and look at the other species in those positions, what we'll find is there's nothing similar at all. But then if we go in the other direction here and we start to look at, see how 1 and 3 are related to each other, which are comprised of C and D versus E through H, we can take a look at some other positions of DNA that tend to match. For example, in E, F, G, and H, in all of these species at position 3, we're going to find the same letter code. So that's how these four wind up being similar to each other. However, E and F will diverge from G and H because at position 5, G and H have C's, and at position 6, E and F have A's. So that allows for a branching point between these two at this node. And up here in position number 1, we'll notice that C and D have G's at position 1, which is kind of unique to them, which allows them to go on their own pathway in terms of their phylogeny. So what we're doing is we're using DNA in order to determine the relatedness of all these species based on what letters they have in common with each other. Now, analogous scenarios can also exist in molecular data as well. For example, these two species here both have C's at this position. They both have A's at this position, C's and T's here, and G's and G's there, which is great. But if you look at all the other sequences, there's nothing similar in these other sequences. So what that tells us is that these matches are just a matter of chance. They don't actually have any connection to each other. They just happen to be the same letters in the same positions. If you take a look at some of the other sequences that happen between our points where we're matching them, look at how similar a lot of these areas are in comparison to what we find in the strip down below. So these are definitely related because we have so many matches amongst the given species. And these can actually go all the way up in some of these cases here where we find the same letter combinations. Down here, we see entirely different sequences in these strips aside from the one or two few letters that match. So therefore, we can call coincidences that occur molecular homoplasies. So they're similar, but they are so by chance, and they have no relationship to a common ancestor. Now, under the umbrella of molecular data, not only do we look at DNA and compare, but we can also look at RNA as well. And the rule basically is this, is that if you have similar base pairing sequences, you can assume that there's a closer relationship than if you don't have, or you do have differing base pair sequences. Then you can only go with being distantly related. We often look at mitochondrial DNA today because of its mutation rate being 10 times that of DNA. We also used to look at protein, and still sometimes do, in order to determine relatedness of two species. We used to use immunological techniques, such as the degree of cross-reaction between two different species, to judge the relationship of how closely related they are. And we can also sequence out amino acids of proteins that two different species have in common. For example, in the electron transport chain, there's a protein called cytochrome C, and we can look at how close the amino acid structure is of cytochrome C in one species versus that of another. And the closer they are, the less difference there are, the more we can assume that those species are more closely related than those that have a differing amino acid sequence for that protein. And lastly, we'll just mention molecular clocks. Mutations have a constant background rate. So what we do is we use non-adaptive nucleotide sequences, the mutations, which are neutral mutations. We assume the constant rate of mutation over time, match that to the fossil record, and what that will do is allow us for an increased strength in the hypothesis. Another thing we can do as we try to reveal homology is look at the embryology and development of an organism. For example, both these organisms here, this fish and this sea star, both develop an anus from what's called a blastopore. So after an egg is fertilized and the zygote develops, during its development it will form this hole in part of its current structure. And in both these cases, what we're going to find out is that the anus will come from that particular structure. Now, what will happen a little bit later in its life is that the sea star is going to go, in terms of its development, and become radially symmetrical, whereas this bony fish here will become bilateral symmetrical. And what we're saying is that each one had at least one part of their life where they matched in terms of their development. So early on, there was a connection, which means they are in some part related to each other. But as development continued, we saw two completely different organisms eventually develop from their DNA code. We can also look at some animals in terms of their embryology and compare them against each other. For example, if you look at these, we can see a lot of different animals from fish all the way to human. We have some mammals in the mix. We have some reptiles, amphibians, and even fish. And early on, we noticed there is a connectedness, a relatedness of all of the different embryos that we see here. A little bit further in development, we notice there are some stark changes in a couple of them. But if you look at, for example, at the pig, the cow, the rabbit, and the human, they still look pretty darn similar to each other. And as we go even further into their development, you clearly see some distinctions between the early ones in this list, the fish and the salamander. You see the tortoise and the chicken's difference. But if we look at, again, pig through human, the fact that we're all mammals lead to the fact that there are similarities that we can still see in terms of our development, which can uncover some of these homologies that we're looking at and that we're trying to study. Let's finish our talk today on the three-domain system. If you remember from our hierarchy of taxonomy, the first taxon, the first level, was the most encompassing, which were the three domains which all other living things fall under. A long time ago, we used to think all organisms were just part of two kingdoms, plants and animals. However, in the late 1800s, they added the protist to that. In 1969, a very, very popular five-kingdom idea was brought forth of monerans, which are basically our bacteria, protista, our protists, plants, fungi, and animals. So what did they base their placement on? Well, first, the type of cell, whether it was prokaryotic or eukaryotic, basically put it in the monerans or in any of these other ones here. The complexity of unicellularity or multicellularity basically keyed out the protists. And the other three, plantae, fungi, and animalia, were basically put in each one based on their mode of nutrition. Now, currently, we know that this is no longer working, this five-kingdom idea, because technology has improved, because of our ability to work with DNA and RNA, and put all these things together, we're able to change the five kingdoms into something different. Unfortunately, protists are going to lose their kingdomship, and they're going to wind up in one of these three kingdoms that we still have around today. The monerans, which we used to call them, are now broken into the bacteria and the archaebacteria, and we'll take a look at that on the next slide. So this tree of life here shows our three domains. We said in 1969 we had the five-kingdom idea, but after that, we started looking at RNA more intently, and what we found was that the RNA sequences, being very similar in certain animals more than another, became the prominent idea on how to classify organisms, and that allowed the three-domain idea to start to be relevant and take precedence over the five-kingdom. So over here, we have bacteria, which includes cyanobacteria, heterotrophic bacteria. Over here, we have archaeans, which are a type of bacteria, and they live in very extreme, inhospitable environments, but life always seems to find a way. And then the eukarya consisted of all these different types of organisms up here. We talked about the five kingdoms no longer being relevant, but instead we have plantae, fungi, and animals, which are now going to inhabit our protists as well. So basically, we saw this rapid change of understanding of where our animals should be classified over the last 40 years. If we look closer at our three-domain system, and by using ribosomal RNA data, it suggests that all organisms evolved along three distinct lineages. First of all, your domain bacteria traits. First of all, they tend to be prokaryotic. They're mostly unicellular unless they live in gigantic colonies that have a lot of communication, asexual type reproduction, heterotrophic, they ingest food, and some happen to be photosynthetic. We also have domain archaea. So in domain archaea, again, we have prokaryotic, and that basically means that they don't have a nuclear membrane, they don't have membranous organelles on their inside, they do have ribosomes, they tend to be unicellular as well, reproduce asexually, have cell walls, have branched lipids in their membranes, and they occupy extreme habitats, as we mentioned before. And then lastly, in domain eukarya, we tend to see unicellular or multicellularity, a membrane-bound nucleus, which is very important, sexual reproduction is very common, and contains the three kingdoms of fungi, plantae, and animalia, whereas protists have currently been subdivided in the rest of eukarya. last but not least, let's take a look at some of the distinctions amongst those three domains of life so you can compare and contrast them with each other. By the way, we're right here if you were looking for where we exist on this current tree of life. But if we take a look at, say, bacteria versus archaea versus eukarya, unicellularity, they're all broken down here to the right, membrane lipids, cell walls, nuclear envelopes, membrane-bound organelles, ribosomes, and introns, all of which are very important when determining whether or not something falls into one category or a different category. So there's a lot of information today, but I hope you took with you that we classify organisms and that we're trying to determine the evolutionary history of those organisms so we can use that information to help us benefit, to keep our biodiversity strong and live more sustainably here on planet Earth. I hope you learned a lot, and I'll talk to you guys next time. See ya.